studio tonight is John Fogerty. And John's sort of returned from a self-imposed exile of recording. It's great to have you back, John.
Well, thank you.
You've been working really hard in your career in music. It started out with just a blast.
That's the part you heard about.
Right? Yeah.
After 12 or 14 years or something, yeah. Suddenly, boom, okay.
There was music happening in the Bay Area, but it wasn't known around the world. But after Creedence Clearwater Revival finished, it really made a mark on the whole world of pop music. And here you are now, after being away for what, a year and a half?
A couple of years, although some reason in my mind it seems, I always say it's about 5 years, because actually when Tom left the group, things were very different after that. It wasn't really it wasn't my best foot forward for quite some time in there.
So that was up until the Creedence album, which one? The Pendulum album?
Right during Pendulum, I think, is when he left, and we sort of hobbled around as a trio for a while, and then, you know, it became, instead of freer, it was actually more constrictive.
Where did you start? You started off with guitar and keyboards and vocals, basically.
Yeah, and like, I guess the best way to say it is when you were a kid and rock and roll has just come along, piano and guitar are almost the same instrument. To me, they were. I mean, it just seemed natural. Sure, we had a piano in our house, so somebody's got to bang on it. And Tom and I went and rented an electric guitar, you know, it was $5 a month, and it was really a piece of growl, but we managed to make two strings go bing-ing and play the piano. And
when were you doing this? We didn't say it, like 12 and 13 years
old? Yeah.
I think that's amazing.
It took somewhere in about when I was about 15, we had a song that demanded, you know, screamed for a sax solo. And so I promised, yeah, okay, we'll go in a sax and I'll play the part on it. And, you know, I didn't know anything about it.
This was all for live stuff, though. Were you just
recording? No, just for records.
So you were playing clubs, basically, but you were really, your mind was really on recording at the time.
Oh, yeah. We found a deal with a guy in Berkeley, not the big record company that's over there, but a fellow that had a recording studio on Alcatraz. Anyway, I must have spent 2,000 hours in that place during high school. It was kind of neat. It was, I learned an awful lot, you know, it was on-the-job training. We were, you know, the Gollywogs or Blue Velvets or whatever, were trying to make a record locally. And the odds of anything like that ever happening is a zillion to one. But finally, you know, Creedence finally did. Is no accident, really. I mean, those good records were accidental, but you want to be able to have it happen more often than an accident.
Well, maybe not quite the right word.
Well, that one doesn't bother me, but it gets used as a negative term here.
Yeah. Functional Fogerty.
That's
functional Fogerty.
Somehow you get this picture of a robot, you know.
I don't know if you really have that image, but I can see how people might think of you as like a music machine, because you handle everything. You were actually managing Creedence too, weren't you?
Sure. Yeah, I was only the manager until it went its four separate ways.
I know. I realize
had to give
that.
In. What do you call that? That's a
compromise.
Yeah, right. That's a good word.
Well, you had to compromise a little bit, John. But
right.
You're doing pretty hot now. I mean, some artists are singled out as either vocalists or performers. They always have one thing that people really want to focus on. And with you, it's really hard because you handle it all.
Well, geez, I don't want to be considered not a performer. I think, you know, when you say that, I just assume not be considered, quote, an entertainer, because I get this picture of an entertainer, and he's got a tux.
Las Vegas.
Now they got bell bottoms. It used to be a Nehru jacket and a pendant, and a certain hairdo, and he'd come out and say, peace. And a lot of jewelry and all that, you know. How you doing, ladies and gentlemen? And the band's going, I don't want to be that. People used to get on our case because our stage thing sounded so much like the record.
You're right. Your stage thing sounds like the record, but then again, I've heard you talk about that.
Well, it just seemed to me that it, you know, I always thought that was a plus.
A compliment. If somebody says your stage still sounds like your record.
Well, I mean, when they say it sounds just like the record, then they're throwing in a little negative twist, and you go, well, you know, that's how they felt about it. To me, I strived to sound like the record because we took all the time on the record, that engineering and all the EQing and balancing and all that stuff that goes on in the engineering booth to make a record sound a certain way. So if we could achieve anywhere close to that in person, I thought that was real great. I mean, Lord knows I've, and everybody, you know, we all have seen enough shows where the sound is horrible and the timing's bad and the group just, you can't hear the voices and, you know, and it's a bummer. But when the sound is great and the thing sounds really good, to me, that's heaven. That's what it ought to be.
I think that's right for your music because your music isn't full of a lot of jams and things like that. But some bands, so I think that they can be you can do two albums and have them both excellent. A live album, which should be different than a studio album.
There you go.
You know?
Right.
But I mean...
Right. But it should be a live album. Like, jams in a studio, maybe 3-4 times in your whole career are you going to really get a jam that's really worth something, and the rest of it is, you know, what that is. I mean, just kind of an extended, I don't want to call it a waste of time, but maybe you could have done what took you 10 minutes, you could have done it in 3 or 2.
Were there any extended jams that you happened to use in Credence, any of the Credence material that you did?
Well, our jams were never quite as totally unorganized as maybe some other group would have done, but I really liked the way Grapevine came off. That was, we had an idea what to do, you know, we had the first portion of the song, we knew what was going to happen, that was fairly well rehearsed. We did one, we kind of thought, well, that's all right, let's do one more, and we did one more, and all the pieces for our ears fit, everything gelled. It was everybody, you know, the guy in the middle turned to each face and said, did you do everything you wanted to do? Yes. Did you do everything you wanted to do? Yes. You know, it was, okay, is there anything more to do? No. I mean, it was, we were all pretty happy with that. That's about the best criteria for it. You know, later there was a bunch of ideas we all thought of. Gee whiz, I should have done this. We should have stopped that idea and gone to this idea, all that kind of stuff.
Well, like effigy, that was kind of extended too, wasn't it?
Right, there was Ramble Tamble had a thing in the middle that probably was too long. I took time out and did a country album, the Blue Ridge Ranger thing, but, I mean, that's obviously meant to be an aside, you know, a parallel. I was, what do you call it, entertaining the idea of doing it for maybe 10 years, you know. Actually, I've thought in terms of a Blue Ridge Ranger type idea since my first couple years of awareness in music. I never really realized, you know, it wasn't that clear to me. I wouldn't have told anybody about it, but in a sense you might say that was why I kind of dominated the group. And I mean, I'm saying that in the most negative way. I probably overdid it in my domination, you know, you do this way, you do this that way, because it was so clear to me how things should fit together.
John Fogerty, do you think of yourself probably not really as just a writer or arranger or producer or a combination of those things, but you are really a record maker?
That's a real compliment to me.
You're really unique in that way. A record maker.
Well, some people think that's less, I don't know, you're more artsy if you just write far out poetry or something, but to me a record is a entity in the universe, all but, you know, separate and apart from anything else in the world, you know, hamburgers or pancakes or whatever people do for a living, you know, a record is a real special thing.
I've heard that you have a song, when you do a song that it's already in your head, and you know how it should sound when it's finished recording. It's easier for you to play those parts than to try to tell somebody else how you want to hear it, or how it is in your head.
Well, past experience has taught me that one. You know, on a cornet or on the drums, I'm obviously not the accomplished musician that Hal Blaine or, you know, somebody that really concentrates on that instrument is. But the key to it is the first thing you said. That's a real compliment to me. To make a record, you don't have to know all that other stuff, you know. If I want to play Moonlight Sonata, I don't have to know everything about Beethoven.
Right.
All I got to know is how to play Moonlight Sonata. So
you have to learn the riffs, right?
Right.
That you want to play.
That's all I have to know. I don't have to know 12 years of practicing scales on the trumpet or something. I just got to know this part. And if I can make it believable for my ear, well, that's all I got to know.
You've done a lot of horns, especially on your new album. But you were doing horns with Credence, too.
Yeah.
But did you ever get a horn part that you just said, wow, all that trouble to get a maybe a couple of lines? Did it seem like that, or was it?
That's only when you start copping out to yourself. Everybody does that at certain times. When you start going, gee, why am I spending a month to learn this dumb little 2-minute thing? But the main thing that keeps you going is next time it'll be much easier, see?
Is that a real thing? Did you spend maybe a month to learn a 2-minute thing?
I did that on the fiddle, yeah. On the Blue Ridge Mountain Blues. Fiddle is incredibly hard. I really bit off more than I could chew. You don't walk in and play a fiddle after a month and try and sound like a champion from Weezer, Idaho.
Exactly.
So as a songwriter, as a guy who writes a tune, I think in terms of AM, because that's where tunes are. That's where, a tune can only have so many twists, and that you can do all the twists for a song in a couple of minutes, really, any more than you're writing a symphony. You're not writing a tune anymore. But as a musician, sure, I scream to play a little longer. Gosh, give me another chorus, you know.
How did you get your background in the music business? I know in the recording industry, you got it just from, you learned on the job training. Did you do the same in the managing area and dealing with the record company area too?
What I always used to say way back when in 68, 69 is we kept hoping, first you could say, why did you become a producer? Well, I kept hoping Phil Spector would come along and take us under his wing and really, all right, you guys are going to do something with you, but nobody ever showed up, so we had to do it ourselves. After the first album, I realized I didn't want anybody messing with my rock and roll. And the same with management. The first couple of decisions were either the label or whatever started saying what we ought to do is, what you guys need is a face man, yeah? And I realized, no, that's not what we want at all. Jeez, we don't want to play at white front grain openings and stuff like that, you know?
So right.
Suddenly I was acting like a manager without realizing...
Looking out for your own interests.
Yeah.
Really, you had to.
And then finally people started calling and say, I want to talk to the manager, and I'd get my best gruff voice, okay, all right, this is the manager, puff, puff, and kind of shut down whatever them weird deals that would come along. It was very effective.
Why don't you talk a little bit about how you find your songs?
I sure wish it was a lot easier.
I'm sure there's not one way that you do it, though.
No.
Maybe you'll give us...
I haven't figured it out yet, because when I'm really hot and my brain's working, I'm really crystal clear. Jeez, I can almost do it at will. But most of the time, it's just kind of, what do you call it? It's busy work. It's like the army,
Really?
Go over there and fold those papers for 5 hours. I mean, it's like I go through all the motions of trying to write songs, and nothing ever happens from that. Nothing ever comes out of doing that.
If you say, I'm going to go sit down and write a song, you never have done that, ever.
Oh, I've almost even finished a couple doing that, and they were just junk, But I believe that maybe when I put in that time, then on the way home, driving home on the freeway or whatever, suddenly something goes, and it all, before I know it, I've written a song without even thinking I'm going to write a song.
Just the lyrics or everything?
Most of the time I write what is called a chorus, or lately a terrible term.
A hook?
Call it a hook, yes. Oh, God, I hate that.
Get the hook.
I don't know, it makes it all sound so sterile and clinical So anyway, I'm going home and I'm trying to write this song, and it might have nothing to do with anything, but I have a hook, and it keeps going through my mind, and finally I work it out with melodies and... don't like that melody, and I'll say it again some other way. So finally, the rhythm of the words kind of demands what the melody will be, right? And half the time, I don't even know what the song's going to be about, though. I'll have a phrase like, I like it, I like it, I like it, right? And I mean, I didn't know what that song was going to be about for maybe a month after that. That it would be rocking all over the world. Even when it became rocking all over the world, I didn't know, was I going to start off in Sydney? Sydney! Melbourne! I mean, I had no idea. I just had this idea about rocking all over the world, and finally decided, nah, that's jive. We'll be right back. I'm not trying to be patronizing at all, but I think of me when I make the records, really. I think of me as the audience.
What you like? Then
well, what
now?
I would like, what I could live with, you know, as a listener. I mean, I guess it is for me, because that's all I know anyway. I don't know what supposedly is going to please somebody else. Probably just how I play right now is different than how I, you know, what I liked 5 years ago. The change is a lot more subtle to you than it is to me. To me, I might call it a big compromise, you know, if I'm playing this certain lick that I never would have dreamed of playing 5 years ago, and it's okay now.
For instance.
I couldn't hum it out, but, you know, the fact that I'll...
Can you mention a lick on a song that you might do now that you wouldn't have done with Creedence, for instance?
No, there's none in there. No, those are all pretty much my middle right, you know, they pleased me. I didn't have to blink or go, ouch. Maybe doing a song like You Rascal You, I might not have done that. I wouldn't have taken a chance on a tune like that 5 years ago. But I really love that song, so I just, you know, when I came up with the idea for doing the old anxiety in the front there, I mean, to me it was so just funky and just, I mean, crazy, just, you know, I mean, how many records have you ever heard that you liked and started with old anxiety, you know, off the wall. It was mainly the melody that got me first, not the meaning of that particular song.
Your new album, you see, you've got like 10 songs, 7 you wrote, and the other 3 you just picked. How do you pick 3 songs that somebody else has done? When you did a whole album with the Blue Ridge Rangers with other people's material, the old familiar tunes, a lot of them.
Right, that was done with a different point of view. The Ranger album was more of me just saying, I think these are really outstanding songs. I don't want to say tribute, that's so corny, but I really, you know, just me saying I really like these songs, not that I'm going to change them or do anything to them, because I really didn't. It was the songs, not my arrangements, you know, they were just great songs.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to, say, taking Lonely Teardrops and putting a different beat to it and you know, jiving it up, as it were. I mean, I see Lonely Teardrops as a song to really get off on with a band.
Good. I mean, even Sea Cruise is the same way. Was that when, just the way you changed that around, you gave it some horns at the end, some foghorn kind of sounds.
To me, that wasn't really a change. To me, it was just a... No, I can't even take any credit for arranging that song. That's...
But it has it, but
how,
it's...
That's how I heard the record. Maybe it's not exactly that way, but if you ask me, I'd say, yeah, note for note. Yeah.
Did you go back and listen to it before you recorded these songs?
Not before, but I did after. Well, yeah, sure, to get the words and stuff, figure out what was going on, sure. But, how can I say it, with Sea Cruise, it really had to be, it had to knock me out, or I wasn't going to do it, because you don't mess with, just don't mess with my rock and roll, and I don't mean mine, I mean our, you know. I wouldn't even touch a whole lot of shaking. I mean, wow, you'd have to be crazy, or Blue Suede Shoes, you'd have to have Mighty Rock's ego, you know? He just had to...
But some people...
You can't touch something like that. But Sea Cruise sort of wasn't quite as classic to me anyway, so I'll try. And the first day I mixed it, it wasn't there, and I was really crushed. I was in tears. I wanted, not, you know... But I really did have it on the album, but it just wasn't there, and I was going to have to throw it away, because you don't mess with something like that unless you think you're contributing, you know?
Right.
And we finally got it right, and to where after it was done and I'd heard my version, then I went back and listened to Frankie Ford's version, and mine actually honks a little better than his does. Mine honks now like I thought his did then.
Did you pick the single off of Rockin' All Over the World, or is that something the record company does?
It was a unanimous decision anyway, but that was, to me, that was the one to start with anyhow.
To start with, but yeah. I think the first one on the other side is a single too.
I do too.
Oh, wow.
Actually, I wrote that song before I left Fantasy. That was all ready to go when I decided, well, gee, nobody may ever hear this one if I stay here.
Some of your music's so reminiscent, especially, it's one that sounds like a Doobie Brothers song, you know? If you want to call it that hook, that guitar hook.
Right. I know which one you're talking about, and I had to have a little conversation with myself, excuse me, to see if I would actually use that or not.
It's like flying away.
Flying away, right. And I asked the guys around the studio and stuff, gee, does that sound like the Doobie Brothers? And I go, yeah, it does, sort of. So I had to finally go listen to the record to see how close it was. The trouble is, as a musician, I know that it's not the same riff at all. Even the timing is a little different from it. First time I ever heard, listened to the music, I just kind of, my mouth dropped, and I'm like, wow, that sounds like the follow-up to Hey Tonight, or something, you know, really, it just was right there, the whole thing. It's a really great record, I really like that one. I mean, I'm not jiving you a bit, it's one of the, say, in the last 3-4 years, it's one of the records I really enjoyed, but it sounded very familiar.
I want to talk about The Wall for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me a little bit about the song? Because you've written many of those kind of songs about almost like being frustrated or...
you hit the nail on the head there. That's one of my anger songs, yeah. All through Watergate, as they say, I refrained from writing any songs because I knew Ray Stevens or somebody would cover it. So I just left it alone, but... Finally, in comes the new cat, you know. I wrote a song called, and it actually wasn't a song. I used to walk home from the job singing to myself, throw the man out and start all over again. And as soon as he came, I started singing it again, as soon as the new guy came. But...
You don't want to use any names, huh?
Oh, that guy they keep shooting at.
Yeah, right, that guy. His initials are...
Wait a minute, I don't want to rub him too bad because he likes my song. He loves Proud Mary, apparently. Anyway, the Mayagüez thing happened, and it was just such a big sham, and immediately the Nielsen ratings, or whatever the ratings are that they have for presidents, went up right after that one, you know, and it's, as the whole thing was happening, you know, let's drop the bomb, get him, kill him. And finally, I just said, well, that deserves a song, I guess, because they're just, you know, I mean, there's not much more I can say. That's what it is. If the wall gets higher, and so you could not see.
Where the River Flows is more of a, it's a John Fogerty gospel kind of song. Well, not gospel, isn't it? I hate to put labels on all your music like that, but mm-hmm. It's that kind of a feeling, yeah. You know? You got the gospel chorus, cowboy chorus.
Right, right. That song, I guess a lot of people think it has some personal, you know, happened to me or something, but it didn't. It just was a song. It just came out the way it did, amazingly. I mean, I saw this picture of this cat, and I saw dogs chasing him, and I saw all this other, you know, he's going across the swamp, and kind of a whole little scenario, you know, like a... The whole thing happened like a dream sequence, and then I tried to write a song about what that was about, but it just unfolded kind of in front of my eyes.
John, what are you going to do now that the album's done? This album's done, you must be about ready to go on the road. You going to do that?
My whole system inside is going, you know, systems are go. Yeah, it's all... Even 6 months ago, I was really wondering, do I really want to do that or not? And, I mean, there's no question about it anymore. I mean, I make records, but I grew up as a musician. I mean, I grew up with, you know, one is the other. You make records, you perform in person. It's just natural. I mean, I really never intended to be a hermit. And now, I mean, I'm at that beginning, you know, first foot forward where everything's possible again. I mean, it's just, I can't see any obstacles. There won't be anything entering to interrupt or stop the flow, as it were. And it's confidence. It's also just maybe it's a simple naiveness, too.
John, thank you for coming by.
Well, thank you.
John Fogerty was produced in San Francisco by Bobby Cole and Richard Gosett.